attending for the second time, which I think clearly I'm very, you know, intrigued. So let me just go and introduce, you know, Goonj and Anshu Gupta, popularly known as the Clothing Man. So Anshu founded Goonj in, you know, 98, and Goonj is, you know, recognized as one of the top 10 most innovative social companies. Clearly what they're doing is quite unique. And, you know, in 2015, Anshu was awarded what is known as the Nobel Prize of Asia, the Ramon Magsaysay Award. And also in 2012, he was named the Social Entrepreneur of the Year, you know, by the Schwab Foundation, which is part of the World Economic Forum. But then it really made all of us wonder, me wonder definitely, that what is it that they're doing that is so unique? So going through, you know, really analyzing what it is, I sum it up in two things, and I'm sure you'll hear the man himself. One is they really believe in the old adage of, you know, give a man a fish, he eats for a day, and teach him how to fish, and he eats for a lifetime. So the whole model of Goonj is around self-help. And that's not just about getting them to work for themselves. It also involves the dignity, right? Where a lot of time, or mostly, how you give is often is more important than what you give. And hence the dignity of the recipient is key. And I think that's what Goonj has shown, how critical that is. The other thing is they don't use money primarily as the currency. What they use is old clothes and now many other old things. So used stuff, but really they extend the life of these products, and it's kind of a barter economy. And it's fantastic because from a circularity standpoint, getting more out of and, you know, extending the life of these products, and actually much more, many more years than what some of us would use these products, and getting that to then in turn be channelized into people working for themselves is just totally amazing and perhaps unparalleled. But when all the good work they were doing, obviously they rise up to the challenge. So when Corona has hit the world and India for sure, and all the millions of migrant workers, and this is where we stand, and this is the update for today. And we will hear from Anshu as to what exactly they are doing and how. And the big question that he asked was quite, you know, it took many of us aback, that why are these people leaving? You know, they've been working for you or around you in your cities for all their life, and in a minute, they're now ready to leave you. They're running away from where? What are they looking for? We've made them feel so insecure that they don't trust us. And I think that is a complete, you know, failure of the whole social system. So what Goonj is doing already, and we'll hear Anshu soon, is phenomenal. They've activated more than 230 organizations across 23 odd states. Several million tons of, you know, ration and goods have been provided. Among other things, they're again going back to their self-help. For example, in the kits they're giving is also seeds, helping people grow their own food. So quite unique in many ways. So let me now not take up any more time and ask the clothing man himself, Anshu Gupta, to really give us an update live from the ground.
Thank you. Thank you, Rajesh. And thank you all for joining. We will keep it, I think, as short as possible. But because there's so much to talk, in any case, the way that COVID disaster is unfolding, so much to talk, we might end up taking more time. But let's make it interactive. What I'll do is that I will also run through a small presentation. Not to talk much about Goonj, but also to talk about the COVID, because the whole idea is that how do we really demystify that? In the next few days, you might find no news of people walking on the roads there. You might again come back to the normal, the way we all have been doing it, that everything is good and fine in village. Because in Indian villages, when 10 to 12,000 farmers commit suicide every day, every year, it's actually not a news. How many of us really know that? And Google also has we are in a habit of very selective learning or selective reading. We type certain words and then we find what do we want to read. So, How many of us really go and talk about farmer distress? How many of us really go and say farming is a skill? This is a very selective reading. In the last two decades of our work, we have done nothing except just talking a lot about the dignity and the skill of the last, you know, mile people. We have been saying that it's not that we only have to value the food, we also have to value the farmer. We also have to understand that 70% of our country is still remain in the country, in the countryside or the villages. And also, you know, the people who have been staying in slums, we have this common, I think, perception which is wrong, which is that slums are the extension of the cities. Normally, if you talk to people in the cities, people say this, that slums are the extension of the cities. And for years, we have been arguing and saying that slums are not the extension of the cities. Slums are actually are the extension of the villages. Because we do not take care of people in their villages or, you know, at the place from where they come from, that is the reason they are forced to migrate and end up staying in the slums. And this particular disaster, to be honest, has actually absolutely proven that right. That slums were always and always an extension of the villages. They were never ever extension of the cities. All kind of rural work. I mean, last year we made almost about 400 kilometers of rural roads. The only difference is that when in our model, people are actually receiving the second-hand and the new goods also as a reward. And we are just trying to make sure that the we do not depend on charity and the giving really is dignified. So when we started with cloth. We started on a very simple thing. We said that half the world does not need a disaster. So why do we wait for an earthquake or flood to happen and then only stand with people? So we never wanted to become a disaster response organization. But for the last two decades, we also realized that poverty is one of the biggest ongoing disasters, whether we understand that or not. Agriculture still needs to be taken care. Farmers need to be taken care. So all those things, you know, ultimately we end up becoming one large institution which is responding to the disaster. So what I'll do, and then the story is very simple. When we started, we started with, is the screen available? Can you see the screen? Yeah?
Yes, sir, we can.
So now I will just, you know, run through this and then we will talk more about it and all the Q&A can come in the chat section. Someone from the team or Rajesh will take the Q&A, the questions, and then we will try to answer that also. So this is just to give you some facts and figures. 1999 formally, 98 informally, about 20 offices, work in 25 states. Whole idea that we collect secondhand and underutilized material from the cities, almost about 6,000 tons of that material in a non-disaster year like this. And then it goes through a very rigorous process of sorting, processing. Then we go to the rural community. Rural community picks up their own work. Someone says we will make a road. Someone says we will dig a well or clean a pond. Some people work on, basically repairing roads or making new roads. And then after a few days of work, they receive that family kit, which is created out of the material which we collect. So two things happen. One is the traditional Shramdan, the strength of India, community work that is revived. And the second most important part that is also the revival of the traditional barter economy, where actually there's no donor, no beneficiary. All of us are a stakeholder. So basically the barter happens between the community's work and community skills with the material which we have in urban parts. It's a barter between the material and the skill and labor. And money is for the logistics of it. And the larger thing is that it is dignified, because the moment you go to someone and give away a shirt or trouser and you say that it belongs to me, the person is forced to say that yes, it belongs to you. But the moment a person does any work, that to hardcore infrastructure, rural development work for a few days, you go give a shirt and say that this shirt belongs to me, the person has a right to say that it might be yours, but I have earned it. So we are actually changing that entire language and that narrative in the process. So it's a completely dignity-led development, as I explained to you. And we are valuing the local communities in the way. No one is going from here and teaching or trying to preach anyone that this is how you should dig a well. Because we all know that the people who are staying there, who have been there for years and decades, they know much better how to dig a well. I think it is often our urban arrogance and the arrogance of our education that we think that not only we can make the most beautiful malls and metros in the city, we can even develop the local bamboo bridge and the bamboo or the wells in the same way. And the fact remains that we actually do not know anything about it. So we actually learn from the village. As I always say that villages have been my university personally and for a lot of us in the institution. But that's how we all work together, find the problem, work on that. And in that, we're also trying to see that how do we really work on the local economies, right? Can the barter take care of some part of their debts so that they don't get into the debt cycles? Can the barter work on the agriculture or water so that the employment also starts happening? And of course, we work with the partner organization. So a few hundred partners across the country, including some units of Indian Army, Border Road Organization, and many other community-based organizations. And to be honest, this particular partnership, which we always used to call that we are laying a grid in the country, which is a grid of relationship, logistics, and all. I think in tackling the COVID to some extent, whatever little we could do in the last 2 months, I think that partnership has been one of the biggest assets for all of us, or that grid has been one of the biggest assets. Let me just come to the COVID part, and then we will chat more on the Q&A. We all know that it is, in many cases, the Indian news is now going out of the media also. And in many other countries, obviously, people are not understanding how it is happening. But this is, imagine that this is a scenario after announcing the social distancing, which I always have been saying from the day one, that social distancing in any case is a wrong word, wrong notion. Because in this kind of crisis, socially, we actually need to be much closer. It is the physical distancing which matters in this particular disaster. But this is how the physical distancing has unfortunately happened. And the irony is that I think we have transferred, because of these things, the disease also to the people who are not responsible at all for this particular disease. Some of the scenes which are very common, and it's not stopped. It's almost 2 months. More and more people are joining this yatra or this all kind of travels, and this is how people are going back. Unfortunately, now it is not even a number. We don't even know. We don't even know how many people and why are they walking. It's just the stories, and stories, whatever comes out in media. The saddest part for many of us, and especially if I talk about myself on a personal note, I think last webinar also I shared the same. As an individual or as an institution, which has been a part of large number of disaster recovery work in this country in the last 2 decades, I think this has been one of the worst, you can say, attack on the notion, on the thoughts, on the feelings of someone. Because I'm still not able to understand that what happened, what went wrong. What is that which people like us, the society, couldn't understand? If we would have treated people well, is that the reason that we didn't treat people well? Or is that the only reason that we didn't treat people well? I mean, imagine these millions and millions of people didn't trust any of the government leader, municipalities, employers, contractors, next door neighbors, anyone on this earth. And despite knowing that there is no bus, train, mode of transport, I mean, imagine someone is walking on the railway track to save themselves from the police also. If they decided to go on this particular journey, there must be something fundamentally wrong, and there is certainly a huge deficit of trust. So that's what we have been telling people, and that's why we are trying to say, demystifying, this disaster is not about distributing dal chawal, okay, or just giving food to people. But this disaster is also to say sorry to millions of these people, and sorry by heart. Because somewhere we have hurt these people. Otherwise, why this little girl or these little kids are walking on the road? I don't know whether people like us will ever understand this. Or once they go there and we start industries here, and then we will just, you know, ask them to come back. And unfortunately, many of them will be forced to come back, because large number of us are not focusing on the Indian villages even today. That suitcase story, I am sure you must have seen, read at many places. But that's just one of the stories. These are like such hundreds and thousands of stories. And apart from that, what you saw, I think the first phase was when everyone was worried about the people stuck in the city. The second phase, which is still there, is a phase where we are worried about the people who are walking on the roads. And the common phase, which hardly any one of us is talking about, is that where are these people going? The phase, the time and the issues in that area. So do understand that this is not a disaster where people are migrating from the village to the city. In many other disasters, when any kind of hunger happened, drought happened, flood happened, earthquake happens, large number of people migrate. So migration in disaster is not a new phenomenon. It does happen every time. Every year when Assam, Bihar, West Bengal, you know, these states are flooded, large number of people actually migrate from these states to the bigger cities. Or when the drought in Maharashtra happens or Bundelkhand happens, large number of people migrate and come to these bigger cities. I believe this is the only disaster where people are actually not migrating towards the cities. People are migrating from the cities. Whether you call it reverse migration or whatever you call it, but it is basically people are trying to go back to the roots which they came from those places 10 years back, 20 years back. It's not that only the people who have just come back from the villages are going back. No, that's not true. And villages which already have been in distress in India, you can understand that the same villages have more people and much lesser resources now. And these are still not in the radar of development. I mean, large number of corporates and foundations also, except some, whosoever is working with us, everyone is just worried about distributing food in the cities. No one is talking about the larger issue in the villages where these people have gone. And they have gone back to the places where, in any case, they didn't have jobs. That is the reason they migrated to the cities. I mean, between me and between them, between you, me, to be honest, and between a lot of them, the only difference is that you migrated by choice. I migrated by choice in most of the cases. But these are the people whom you saw walking. Most of them actually migrated by compulsion, not by choice. And they are actually going back to the places which And there are three phases. One is the immediate phase, which is obviously the hunger, starvation, whatever you call it. The second phase is of the debt, because I was just talking to our team and partners there in West Bengal, which is going through one of the worst cyclone. Recently what happened. That cyclone itself is a very big disaster, but because it is mixed up with this particular disaster, no one is trying to understand that what people are going through. And the going rate of $30 per month. So if you have to buy a bamboo and grass for making your hut and it costs you about 10,000 rupees, you are actually paying 3,000 rupees per month on just that small bamboo and grass item. And the third, obviously, much bigger issue, which we all of us need to really stop somewhere, that if we do not work in the villages of India, if we do not create further employment and a little bit better life, the people who came here earlier in distress and went back in distress, again will be forced to come back in distress. This is what we have done. This is till last Friday. Not this Friday, it's last Friday. Every Friday we punch the data and Monday we release it. So more than 250 partner organizations we're working and have been able to channelize about 1.2 million kgs of ration and other essentials so far. The only difference is that large part of it we are buying locally so that the local economy is also supported. On Monday, we release the new report. So this Monday, we'll make sure that all of us who have registered for this webinar will get a copy of that. Otherwise, also, it is always updated on our social media by Monday night or Tuesday morning. Just to give you some glimpses. So this is something interesting. Now it is touching about 83 kgs now. 83,000 kgs this week, if I pick up the latest data. So what we realize that you saw a picture of tomatoes in Kolar in Karnataka. So farmers have been growing, but there was no system to really buy or transport for the stock, all that kind of stuff. So what we started doing that instead of just depending on the city material, we started reaching out to the villages and started making these vegetable kits for people to go as a food kit. And very large part of the procurement and you know, it is in such a distress that we were so shocked to see that how a farmer in Bihar is ready to sell a quintal of green chili, fresh green chili for 400 rupees, which is 4 rupees a kg. Or how the farmers in Kolar are ready to sell a quintal of tomato for 200, 300 rupees also. Because instead of throwing, they thought that even if I get 2 rupees a kg, it is absolutely fine. Which does not even recover their cost. I mean, I'm not even talking about labor. I'm not even talking about the debt which they have to pay or the interest which they have to pay in on that money. So this is where this approach came up and it's going on well as of now. And with this, we also started doing, and Kerala, we have also got our first spinach, in the field now. People have started selling it. Right in the beginning, we started giving seeds to people. So in the last few weeks, we have done about 300 kgs of seeds to the with our family kits and all, so that people can really start growing their own vegetables. So A, they get something nutritious in this tough phase of food crisis. And B, they also get some income in the process. Just some glimpses of what is happening all across the country in the deeper pockets. Now, other important part for all of us is the neglected communities within the neglected communities. So one, the rural India in any case is neglected majorly. But if you just see some of these categories which are written on the screen, and please understand that India is a country of volume. Fine. India, there is nothing in thousands or not even in lakhs. It's all ultimately, it goes in millions. So if you see tribal population, if you see the sex workers and the transgenders community, HIV positive, leprosy patients, weavers and artisans, tea garden, weavers and artisans, imagine I can explain, one very peculiar position. Or situation that in any other disaster, many of you must have done it. We all work with the artisans, weavers, or mask makers, flute makers, basket makers. And then we also try to see that, how do they get better price for their product? Those products are even sold to get more money for the communities back in the villages or in the apartment where they work. Now, see this particular disaster that even if you go to a weaver and say that fine, let's support weaving, where is the buyer? Where is the immediate buyer right now? Because even those markets are closed. So this is such a sad thing. I think, in Bengal, these beautiful musicians of Bengal have come together and to really work with us and to raise money now with their art, with their music. just to make sure that all the musicians in West Bengal at least start getting some cash. Because if the live shows are stopped, what will happen to the people who were there on the flute, tabla or harmonium or any other instrument? What is going to happen to them? Because the senior guy can still come on the Zoom and sing, might not get that money, but still can survive. What about the other support artists which are there in millions? I mean, in the entire film industry, that's the whole issue people are facing. That the actors will still survive because they have made a lot of money. But what about the people who were there, or those hundreds and thousands of people who were there on absolutely daily basis or like a daily wages? So we are trying our best to reach as many people as possible, but I am opening up these subjects so that wherever you get an opportunity, try to work with these hidden or the neglected communities, with whomsoever you want. It's not about, I am not here to talk about Goonj and say that send money to Goonj, Goonj, Goonj. Goonj is just some small tiny institution which is trying to do its own bit. But the whole idea is that we just bring attention to these issues, because this disaster is still unfolding. It is not that it is going to get over like any other disaster. Any other disaster, for a few minutes or for a few days, from say earthquake to flood, it used to happen. Very next day, you get into the recovery phase of it. But this disaster, it started with the health disaster, got into displacement, joblessness, hunger. It is just unfolding. So just see how you work with these communities, with whosoever you want. But more important for us is to work with as many people as we can. This is just, interesting part. This is an old picture. That is why you see, otherwise a mask is one thing which you will always see in all the pictures nowadays. I think that has become an identity of the new world for the time being. But what we do, as I explained in the initial phase, that we have this program called Dignity for Work, which used to be called Cloth for Work earlier. And that is where the entire relief material or the Cloth for Work kit, which we used to call, that goes to people. And this is how people get together. They hundreds of them actually work on such ponds and as per their local needs. So in this disaster also, we are back with these work. We have already done about 200 odd kitchen gardens, individual and institutional. We have done almost about 95 plus in the last few days, because it all started after May 17th only, when it started opening up in India. That is where communities are now getting together, making bamboo bridges to making roads and all. And then with a lot of dignity, they are receiving that relief kit. So Dal Chawal is not, they are not getting it as charity. Even when they eat that Dal Chawal or whatever, or the our kit has a lot of other material also, right, from sanitary pad to toiletry. I think while using that, they will be much more dignified, because it's not just a charity. This is what they've literally earned it by doing or contributing to these works. The other major approach, which all of us really need to understand, and if you all can work on it, we call it Vapsi, which means just coming back. So we identified that, what are the local professions in the villages? Why do we, whenever we talk about village economy, why do we only talk about papad chaat, achar murabba, or maybe some stitching jobs? Why can't we have some other jobs also? Because if you have like a village of 300 families, you can understand that there must be at least 100-150 bicycles there, or 100 cycles there. So if put together two villages, if we have a puncture shop, the guy will always have a business, or a cobbler, or a tailor, roaming tailor who goes and repairs the stuff, or the village huts. If we have more smaller huts where only the village people are authorized to sell, not the big lalas from the city. So we post Bihar floods, we actually worked extensively on this in 2008, and we reached out to about 22,000 families. In this COVID, we have already started it, right from the beginning. And it's obviously because it is a pan-India disaster, so we are taking different approaches, but it's working well. In the next few days, in the reports, just keep an eye on that how it is progressing. these important relationships to Kashmir, we are actually working with the army only. And then plus hundreds of these partner organizations, 250 odd are already activated for this particular work. It can certainly be scaled up. It can certainly be replicated because there is a robust pipeline which is already laid. And this cannot, right now, it cannot stop. It only needs to grow as much as possible, because as I'm saying again and again, that it is still unfolding. And the Indian informal economy, which is known for, people used to say that it will be able to hold it because it's an informal economy. The other part of informal economy is also that a large number of people, very large number of people, are actually surviving on daily wages. So if for two and a half months you do not earn your daily wages, you can understand in what situation you really get into. This is just the last slide of mine, and then we open up for Q&A for some time. I don't know how much we know about this Amphan cyclone, because in itself it would have been a cyclone. It is obviously as big as earlier any other big cyclone. Even in West Bengal in 2009, we had Ayla, or recently Fani and all in various parts of the country, especially in the eastern part of the country. So it is one of the major cyclone which has devastated about, say, for sure, the south and north Chaubis Pargana, plus a couple of more districts and the city of Kolkata in a very, very big way. Number of deaths might be less because obviously, now the preparations happen to handle it. But please do not understand the gravity of a disaster by the number of deaths, because in any case, people like us can serve for the people who are still living, not for the dead people, unfortunately. So a cyclone which does not leave even the pakka buildings or the towers, how will this cyclone affect the millions and millions of kacha houses? We don't have to think twice about it. And please understand that in West Bengal, it is a top-up disaster. Such a massive disaster in the middle of already ongoing disaster, which is on for almost a couple of months. So the situation is certainly bad. And imagine there are two disasters. One talks about that you maintain distance, and the other disaster talks about you come together and work together. So it's, in any case, it's a very complicated situation, even for our teams and partners there. And for sure, right, otherwise the problem has been hunger in various other parts of the country. In this case, it is hunger and home. Both have become a larger problem. So I just thought I'll share these details with you, and then come back and cover more aspects in the Q&A. Just take it as just the opening remark. Thank you.
Wow, as ever, it's kind of, it hits you. I think we've started getting a lot of questions, but so we'll open up. So anybody wants to ask questions, raise your hands, or, there is a raise your hand option, right? Or people can just start talking. I will just take one opening in the meantime, people can gather their thoughts. So I think Vapsi has been on your agenda even before, right? To try and, push the whole de-urbanization, that how do we help, right? So I think this has now come, and there is a natural gravitation. But obviously, as you're rightly saying, unless you enable it, it won't sustain. Right?
Rajesh, I can't hear you.
Oh, sorry. So I'm saying the whole Vapsi part, de-urbanization, making people comfortable when they are back in their villages, or creating opportunities for them. So you've had this as on your agenda even from before COVID, right?
Yeah. So 2008, we experimented in this, and experimented in a very, very big way. More than 22,000 families we worked with, and we actually identified about 30 different professions where people really need to work. I mean, you will not believe, many of the people laugh on this, but if you go to the village today and you go to a woman, or especially the young girl, And you start again in a very traditional, very, I think, useless way. You start talking about stitching, because we in India, we only think that women only knows stitching or cooking, nothing else. And you start talking about giving a profession of stitching. They actually refuse, because most sought after profession for a young girl in the village is now something to do with the beauty parlor, something to do with the mehndi. And what we are not understanding that, you know, you might be financially poor, but you have the same aspirations. You also enjoy your festivals like anything. You also want to wear good clothes, look good, use mehndi and whatnot. But we do not consider that as a profession at all when we talk about village India. As I'm saying, we still talk about achar, papad, murabba. But that's not done. So, and then the other thing, that if I give the larger picture, we need to understand that when we say that 70% people stay in the villages, why don't we understand that 70% customers also stay in the villages? Why should it happen that village should only and only produce for the cities, for people like us? Why does it happen that the farmer who is producing food is hungry and people like us are well fed? So this actually has to reverse, completely has to reverse somewhere. The village people need to produce for themselves first, and then whatever is left over needs to come to the city. I mean, I'm very clear about it. So why, instead of making fancy carpets for urban India to buy from the most expensive shop, why can't these people weave simple dari or simple carpet for themselves? They also need something to sleep. And then we send it from the cities for them to sleep. How does it operate? I don't know. It is produced in the village, come to the city, then from the city we send it back to them, instead of they consuming on their own. So we are just trying to reverse that in a big way, and that's where we need all the people to come together.
Anyone there wants to ask a question, you can go ahead.
Yeah, Yamini, I think you are raising your hand. I can see that.
Yes. Yeah.
You need to unmute yourself.
Hi, Yamini, how are you? Good to see you. Go on.
You need to unmute.
Yeah.
Firstly, a big hello to Rajesh sir, whom I'm meeting after a long time, and then a big thank you to Anshu. Thank you for sharing the link on LinkedIn, Rajesh. That's how. So, I mean, firstly, it's very exciting. You know, of course, it's painful, but what's exciting is just hearing that actions are happening. And I'm here in London, you know, I can only read and occasionally donate to organizations. So I'll just pick up two or three points from everything that you've said. First, this is fantastic that here is an opportunity to actually rebuild the rural economy. And I've been hearing, you know, strategies that are being worked on, that can we make this a self-reliant, cohesive ecosystem, probably like or somewhat like adapted from, you know, the original ideas of whatever it was, Panchayat Raj and everything, that then got overtaken by mass industrialized scale economies. So I think one thing is, I've noted that you are no longer using just recycled clothes as the currency, but finding other ways of compensating people for their efforts, which is very important, and also rebuilding. Now, one thing is about skills development. So, you know, I leave that to you, but very, you know, it would be great to explore what can be done in skills development. And these skills development are to produce goods or services for which the rural people are the consumers themselves. As you say, let's not forget that they are the consumers, so they can be producing everything that's needed for themselves. And I guess the only other question was that the pressure, the focus, as Rajesh would know, has been so much on these industrialist supply chains producing at scale and then transporting goods all over. So I think it would be interesting to know how we can push back on mass scale produced goods, but actually take employment into the villages. Right, that's it.
So just to summarize it, that, you know, right from the beginning, to be honest, we are not limited to clothes. These are just perceptions, fine. So because, like, if another beautiful organization working with kids, so we think that they are only working on kids, although they must have grown in the last 2 decades a lot. So that's how we are also doing this. There is nothing new, right? I mean, this 6,000 tons of material which we collect actually has a small part of cloth, but more also part of, right, from furniture, old wash basin to doors, windows, fans, tube lights, everything. Okay. The second part is, for sure, it is a chance to for the rural India to, if we are really serious about it, fine. I think that the nation has to be very serious about it. In the cities, what is happening right now and the way we are diluting the labor laws and all, I think that's a very risky trend, because that. But if the people who have seen it, that because of if we really value the people because of whom we are sitting inside our homes and have been eating food, if we really emotionally value and we do not only worry about our numbers and big buildings and all that, then only it can happen. Because we have been using farmer either as a farmer or as a labor. Right? I am not worried much about these skills. Right? I'm being very upfront on this, because this is basically people like us who have the, I don't know what, maybe the arrogance to call other people unskilled. I mean, otherwise the people who have been growing 100 different kind of rice, how can we even call them unskilled? I don't even know how to grow a small, flower of rose in my garden, despite having Google with me. Right? So this is something, whether we are really valuing people for what they are. Have we ever gone to dig a well? No, but they have been digging wells. Have we ever gone to make a bamboo bridge? No, but the entire Assam, entire Northeast is walking on bamboo all across. So I think it is our arrogance. It is, because we think that we have come to the best possible institute and that is where we have suddenly become skilled. I mean, how do you bring a farmer who is working and growing 100 different kind of rice, who can add 2 mango and create a third variety of mango? How can you call that person unskilled and bring that person to the city, make him a plumber and say, now he is skilled? So the entire definition of skill itself is wrong. They don't need that, period. We need that, that's why we call it skill. Dr. Bajaj, Dr. Geeta Bajaj. Rajesh, I can also see, so I am directly
sure,
taking over your role also.
No, go ahead.
Yeah. You need to unmute and we will keep it short because, I think it's, yeah.
Hi, thank you so much. I think that was very, very informative and you're doing some very critical work, and also for raising such fundamental issues. I think it's very important that we start thinking about it, at least if, you're way ahead. I want to know that how can somebody who's living outside of India, who's an NRI, contribute or do something other than, of course, contributing in ways of funds? Are there other ways in which we can do something?
So, I'll give a very simple answer, which I've been giving everywhere. You need to find out whether it makes sense for you or not. So I'm saying that every one of us should spend an hour after this conversation with ourselves. And on one sheet of paper, we should write every single connect and contact we have in life. Mm-hmm. Every single connect and contact, fine. So I might be connected with someone in some country on something. Someone must be a general manager of some company somewhere, whether it's an education company or a product company or whatever. On the second page, we should actually just make a note of all these strengths we have. And when I say strength, your strength is not that you are an MBA, so you know business, things well. You might be a really, really nice singer, but you were only recognized in your small group. You were never recognized otherwise. But you might be a good singer, right? You might be a good artist. Who knows? What we need to understand that this world right now does not need only dal chawal. Fine, that is the need of the hour, because you can only sustain when you survive. Okay, so obviously that is the need of the hour. But when the world opens up, and the way it is opening up, it is going to be a completely, completely different world. I mean, if I talk about India today, and India, what the Indian story is not Indian only. Indian story is actually true to larger population of the world. Millions of people for the last 2 months are actually staying together as a family in the 40 to 60 or 70 square feet of their so-called home, with the common toilet, they used to survive based on their public spaces. Mostly they used to be on the roads, on the roadside or the public parks and all. So can we imagine the number of cases of domestic violence, domestic abuse, sexual harassment, all kind of other diseases which will come up, all kind of psychological issues which will come up. So I'm even saying that Dr. Yadi, I mean, even if you know that you are a person to whom six people really listen for half an hour, they don't get bored, you have that strength and skill because people even need that right now. I mean, every day when we open up, we don't read newspapers and I mean, in India, in any case, a lot of people have stopped connecting with the media the way it is operating. But still, in many nations, whatever piece you pick up, even today, if you pick up your Facebook, any social media, anything, either you get the pictures of someone cooking something, because obviously that's a new thing in people's life. They've never done it, most of them. Or the only other news is the news of distress. So how do we start bringing that positivity? I mean, I try to put something on my Facebook. I'm an absolute failure right now. And for the next couple of months, I'll be a major failure in putting something positive. Not that I'm not trying. I'm certainly trying. But when, as an institution, as an individual, you deal with these negative things and you're trying to tackle that. So often I don't post anything. But people like you, people like many others, if you map your strengths today, I'm pretty sure that a large part of other skills and things will come up, which you can do with other people.
Okay. So supposing we figure out our strengths, and I'm just picking up one, for instance, you mentioned writing, right? So does one, and you're sitting outside, so obviously you are a secondary reporter and not a primary reporter of anything, right? And therefore you need to have people or need to have access and all. So does Goonj, is there ways of connecting with
Nikhil, to be honest, with the you are in the Google world right now, so access is never a problem. Just that I think whenever we do these things, we should be very open to understand that not everyone will respond to whatever you're doing. Right? Because like suppose today a writer comes to us and five writers come to us and say we are writing, use our stuff. We might not be able to use immediately, because we're too busy in taking care of hunger, right? Mm-hmm. But then there must be other institutions, other people who will make use of it. So I'm saying that don't give up. If you really understand that it is your strength and it can really contribute in this particular, you know, recovery process of the disaster, if it fails at one place, two places, go to the third place and sign up. I'm pretty sure that they will be taker of this thing. You should not lose patience, because unfortunately, you know what has happened, that there are hundreds and thousands of these, especially the social development organization. They were working on hundreds of different issues. Someone was working on education, someone was working with women or health or domestic abuse, you know, or some positive learning, whatever. In the last 2 months, all of them are forced to leave whatever they were working on. All of them are working on hunger now. So unfortunately, that's the new priority for some time. But I'm pretty sure that it will be normalized soon. At least normalized in the sense, I'm not saying the life will be normal, but I'm saying that people will have to come back to their normal work also, because those are also exactly the same. I mean, are needed in the same way.
Mm-hmm. Thanks.
Rajesh, you need to unmute.
So we've had Kumari Pooja there. She's raised her hands. Maybe, you know, we should ask her. She raised it a while ago. You want to ask your question? Sorry. Pooja, are you there? Can you ask your question now? You've raised your hands. Okay, doesn't look like so. All right, we'll just go to... So, Anshu, there's some other questions coming about how can students help, interns help. You know, a lot of students are back in their, you know, hometown now, and they want to help.
So, I think what we need to understand that it's a major issue with the education right now. Fine. Because unfortunately,
we lost Anshu, looks like. Are you there, Anshu? We've lost you, I think. I think he'll probably dial back in. In the meantime, I must say that, you know, we've been, I think one of the things I feel that, for us to transport ourselves to a village and all in these situations is not easy. We are sitting in different parts of the world or even in cities. So definitely trying to get more resources. I mean, there's a lot of, you know, people, a lot of organizations have come up. There's even fraud, you know, people saying, I don't know if I'm giving my resources, support, contributions to the right place. I think, it seems like from whatever we are hearing, Goonj is doing a tremendous job. So at the moment, yes, in the long run, I think we need to do more than just, money. It's a lot of things we can do. But clearly for now, especially when the requirement, and I'll let Anshu come and tell us where right now, even the old clothes has become a slight challenge. Perhaps because, you know, of the way right now people don't need just clothes and all, they need food, they need, you know, to get back, and the logistics and all for that requires different kind of resources. So clearly giving that to Goonj right now would be the best thing we can do. I've got some other colleagues from Goonj. Do you know if Anshu has just dropped off or is it I think I am trying to look. Okay, there is, maybe we can go. There is a question from Dhiren. You want to ask your question, Dhiren? We will.
Yeah, Rajesh.
Yes.
Yeah, I was just waiting for it. I thought it lost, but you came back. Good. So my question was, I think it's a great job Goonj is doing. And I know about this, you know, when I was in EY, so I know that they were associated and we're doing some job around, you know, supporting them. Primarily, my point is the way we are looking forward for, so the way we are supporting the villages in Vapsi, my view was that, you know, why can't we identify some opportunities, like, you know, we were highly dependent on China or maybe in import point of view, many of the country. With this pandemic, why can't we find some sustainable thing which we can, you know, transit from what was happening in China and we were importing and make that methodology or technologies brought to the villages and uplift that village from a sustainable perspective, right? Feeding is something you can do for a time being. No, again, offense to Vapsi. But Vapsi is taking us back to, you know, what traditionally we're doing, which is slow process. I will not say it's not an outcome, but it is, you know, hindrance to the current digitized world or automated thing which we have. So how should we look forward for finding out opportunity which we bring to villages and they become self-sustainable and resilience to the things which are there?
So Rajesh, I'm back. I think there was some connection problem. Yeah.
Go ahead.
So Dhiren, I didn't hear the entire question. I could hear the last part of it. If you can summarize, Rajesh, then I can.
Yeah, I'll just quickly summarize it. Essentially saying with all the change going on and, you know, is there an opportunity of creating manufacturing or other things in India, for example, in villages, things the way the shift, potentially people are thinking there might be a shift away from China and, you know, more a localization of supply chains. Is this an opportunity for the rural India to you know, create versus...
So there is, there is certainly a lot of opportunity. I think our problem is that we are still not valuing the rural India. I mean, even if you see all these schemes, it is always just give away, you know, these few hundred rupees to someone. But that's not the way we should tackle the rural India. Rural India is the hub of skills, right? And right now with this reverse migration, we should also understand that even if there were particular thing which was lacking, so suppose a village didn't have a mechanic, Now they have mechanics, they have everyone. They have accountants, they have software engineers, they have everyone. Because, you know, to whom we are calling migrant labor, it's good that we are calling everyone a labor, because ultimately I am also a labor. So it's good that someone is calling software engineer also a labor and accountant also a labor, because in that entire crowd of migrant people, it was not just a daily wager. It is basically a mix of many people like us. There are people who were earning 50,000, 1 lakh rupees, but not paid for last 3 months. And they were shunted out by their landlords. And that is why they were walking. We have met many people like that. Right? So now the Village India has, in any case, Village India is very talented. But in any case, if there was something missing, that has come now. So a lot of things can happen from there. I mean, why can't the rural BPOs operate? Simple example, very small example. Why should even the rural problems will be solved by the cities? That what is needed in the agriculture, why should someone sitting in Delhi, you know, talk about it? Why can't go to a tier 2 town and then start doing it? Why can't you sit in Saharsa and talk about farming in Bihar? So it is an opportunity for those so-called budding entrepreneurs all across the country, that they also leave their comfort because they think that they are very comfortable in Bombay and Delhi. I mean, this is time for them to really move out a bit and see what is more sustainable and what is needed. Do we again want to make mistake to bring them to the cities and then you know, exploit them? Or we can go there and do something. And also, very important, just one single point, let us also, you know, go beyond thinking that village means agriculture only. I think our problem is that we only think about agriculture when we talk about village. The fact remains that most of the products which people like us are consuming are largely coming from the villages. Every single cotton fabric what we wear, all the good shawls which come from Bhujodi in, Gujarat, all the nice sarees, cotton sarees which come here. Tell me how many handicrafts are actually created that way in the cities. Across the country, there are hubs where the handicrafts are made. The most famous, you know, those mukhotas or the masks are made in some parts of West Bengal in Purulia. The entire Madhubani arts which we buy for thousands of rupees in Delhi Art and other places is actually created in Madhubani. So they are extremely, extremely skilled people.
We agree, Anshu.
We have to change our lenses.
I completely in sync with idea, and I have no, you know, that for me, every individual has some talent and he can contribute in his area. The point is how, you know, Gunj can take this up, not limited to barter, but to set up the, you know, small scale industries.
We will not do everything, Girish.
Okay.
No, we are not the president and the prime minister of the world or the nations. We are one organization. We will do whatever best we can. Whosoever thinks that there are other approaches, this world needs, there is no debate on either or, there is a debate on and. So if you feel something really nice or strong about it, you have an opportunity now. The virus has given you an opportunity to leave your cushy, comfortable thing and get into much bigger, much cushier thing. All of us who are asking other people to take actions, all of us have a chance to take actions now. Do not depend on, I think the irony is in this world, in this country, is that every good work should happen through social development organization. Why should it happen through social development? Our role is to fill the gaps. Our role was never to take care of the food for everyone. That is government's role. Our role is to fill the gap.
True.
Simple.
So there's still a question, Anshu, which several had asked, and this Kirti has asked here about what can students do. I think we lost you when you were answering that.
So, you know, one thing, I can give you a larger scenario right now. This disaster, especially in India, has also shattered the dreams of millions of people. Because if you see the migration pattern, a large number of people actually sell their livelihood, I mean, the livestock or the land and all, to bring their kids to the better schools. They also come to the cities in search of better schooling. This entire Kota belt, which had so many hundreds and thousands of students, large number of them are coming from those smaller towns, you know, because the good education is aspiration, for sure. As of now, we don't know what it is turning to, because I am certainly worried with all this online education a lot, because just before COVID, there were hundreds of people who were looking for the de-addiction center of laptop and mobile for their kids. And suddenly the same parents are tuned to the mobile and laptop 7:30 in the morning to get e-classes. And my suggestion to you that the world will not fall if for 6 months we will not study. It's very simple. I think this is a golden time for a whole lot of us, for the new generation, for the kids, to really enjoy their life whatever way they can, to play more Ludo and Snake and Ladder and Carom than just worrying about education. This is a massive attack of education, because obviously when I am talking to schools and I'm saying, why are you forcing kids to get up at 7:30 and get into their online classes? I believe that there must be a business model, because if you don't teach, how do you get the fees? That must be a business model, but that's an absolute injustice to the kids. So the students who are trying to do something good, I can advise you one very simple thing. Take this time to do good for yourself first, because in the last many years, you also succumbed to all kind of pressures. Your peer group, you were also chasing marks like anything. You never knew that there will be an year where even the exams are not confirmed, and you were unnecessarily chasing those marks, because that's what schools have been teaching these days, unfortunately. So for a month or two, chill, relax, worry about yourself and see where do you want to see yourself in the time to come. And then if you are clear about yourself, I'm pretty sure that you can stand with 10, 15, 20 more students. Finding people in need is not a problem for the people who want to do it. So basically, and anywhere you find a gap, we are there.
Hit the reset button, basically, for the world.
Reset button, absolutely.
I think we can take one last question that several have asked on this, about the whole issue of mental health of people, especially, I guess, the people who are returning back, migrants. So have you anything you can talk about that?
So, Rajesh, we are talking for sure. We are talking, but you know what happens is that in the list of priorities right now, when the hunger becomes much bigger problem, and then the employment becomes much bigger problem, then the family relations become a bigger problem. So I think people have to live with it. And the worst part is that if you see the larger population which has gone back, in any case, was the world really careful to talk about their mental health in any case? मुझे आप मतलब यदि सोच के बताएं तो ये जो करोड़ों लोग वापस गए थे, crores of people or lakhs of people who have gone back, how many of us were really really worried about their mental health? We were absolutely fine to have 20 bottles of best possible whiskey and rum at our place, but we were very worried that कि ये बंदा रोज पीता है, this guy drinks on a daily basis, because we have been living with these double standards. So I am saying mental health is a very, very big issue, but only when people like us really get up and understand that this mental health issue is not only for the families like ours, but for every single citizen. Why have we taken it as a normal that haan maid hai to pitti hai? It's very sad that her husband really beats her. But haan, you know, this is what it happens in this society. These are our normal sentences, fine. And this is utter hypocrisy, but this is how we all have been living. I always say that the society, there are a lot of people who want to live and who want other people to survive. There are different ways of looking at life. It is going to be a major problem for sure. There is no doubt about it. And I don't know the country where the health systems are not that good, where the priority for the next 1 year is just COVID, and where the health systems used to be, in any case, inadequate. 4 o'clock, you go to AIIMS and then get into line to get an appointment, and those hospitals are closed for all the patients. So these are repercussions. These are larger, deeper repercussions, and we have to live with it. And if anyone here, that's what I'm saying, that if you are a person who has a strength that 5 people listen to you, this is a time that you do that. Because if five people listen to you, what do you need in this particular case? That you need people who listen, to whom you can say, you can just talk, with whom you can laugh. So that is where all of us, whosoever is here, at least that role all of us can play, where we will not get into our preaching head and tumko aisa karna chahiye, you should operate like this, you should live like this, you should eat like this, as if we know everything. Fine. I mean, many times these urban students come to us, you know, and they actually say ki nahi, but you know, sir, the slum kids never want to study. So I always tell them that, do you really want to study? I mean, how many of us really wanted to go to the school? I never wanted to go to the school. I only started going to the school when I started making some friends there. So I used to go not for the studies, but for the friends. And why do we think that every single person who has done 10th standard, 12th standard can actually teach anyone? Not every single educated person can become a teacher. No. So I think it's very time, as you said, Rajesh, reset thoda apne ko hi karna padega pehle. We have to reset our own thought process, our own, where do we stand, and then go somewhere.
I think the, you know, Maslow's hierarchy of needs has inverted. The basics and essential requirements, which are at the bottom of the pyramid, right? And you go to the higher end at the top. Right now it's inverted. People are really focused on the basics. And what you're saying is right, that, you know, yes, mental health is probably a domino effect. It is seemingly, it is becoming now, it's coming, right? As people realize, you know, whether it's joblessness, you know, being stuck, and obviously much more for the migrant workers, you know, their whole life is totally destroyed in many regards. Okay. Sure. Any other? If not, we'll have to close. I think we kind of said we will try and remain in time at 6:09. I think to summarize and close, we have a platform. Goonj has created a pipeline of projects, a business model, innovation, combination of goods, and right now does need funds as well. I think the best we can do is channelize it from there and spread, you know, and we'll have few more sessions in coming weeks and all, and, you know, invite people, like-minded people, if you found this session good and useful, because a lot of people had been asking, you know, how do we help? What should we do? And I think, you know, one of the ways, and as rightly you said in the beginning, Anshu, that, you know, it's, there are many, many organizations. So of course there are many, Goonj is one of them, but clearly, you know, seems to be doing the right thing, and we should just enable it. I think scaling up of your efforts is what we can enable and do the best. So thanks so much. I'm sure we will send out an update, right? And a summary, and also links to how people can, you know, get connected, volunteer, contribute, resources, support. So I think that we look forward to that email and look forward to the next session, Anshu. Thank you so much.
Goonj.org and the Goonj social media is updated. We don't update like many times in a day, in a very balanced way, but you will get the glimpses of the work. The work is on in 23 states. And of course, all of us need to work together. All of us have to stand together. And I'm just waiting for the positive stories to happen, and I'm sure it will happen soon. Thank you very much. Stay safe. And as I say, lage rao. Don't sit.
Thank you. Bye. Thank you so much. Bye-bye.